In this month's economic update, Kaplan Professional Education's Trevor Trahan speaks to an industry economist about the short-term domestic and global economic outlook.
Welcome to Kaplan Professional Education's monthly economic update. I'm Trevor Trahan, and today we're speaking with AMP's chief economist, Shane Oliver. Thanks for joining us today, Shane.
Thank you.
The ABS said Australia's economy grew 1.1% during the March quarter, its fastest pace in 2 years. What drove that growth?
Well, it was certainly a stronger than expected outcome, particularly compared to expectations just a week or so before. But the main driver was very strong resource exports. So basically what's happened there is that we've had the mining investment boom. Some of those mines are now complete and they're now starting to produce exports, and that's what we're seeing. So there was a huge element from the resources sector. There was a bit of strength in housing construction starting to come through, but a big chunk of the growth was the resources sector, so it's probably not going to be sustained at that rate going forward.
After a slowdown of growth in China earlier this year, what indications have there been of China's growth rate stabilising?
Well, it's certainly the case that growth in China slowed through the first few months of the year. Most indicators, be they industrial production, retail sales, investment generally, and also some of the some of the private surveys coming out of China certainly showed a slowdown. And that's been evident in commodity prices. Whether you debate the data or not, you can't deny commodity prices were soft, and that partly reflects the softness in China. Recently, though, we're starting to see a bit of an improvement. As we went through April, it seemed like the data was stabilising. Then in May, the figures for industrial production, investment, retail sales, various business surveys have shown a slight uptick in growth. And I think that tells me that the Chinese slowdown has probably come to an end, and that growth might be starting to pick up a bit, and also that some of the mini stimulus measures that the Chinese authorities put through over the last few months are starting to help.
Some figures are suggesting the economic recovery in the US is easing slightly. What is the overall state of the US revival?
My feeling is that the US revival is on track. Earlier in the year, there was some bad weather in the US and a few other things going on, and that combined to create a decline in a contraction in the US economy in the first quarter. Since then, we've seen a range of indicators in the US pick up. For example, the labour market has improved on quite a sustainable basis, obviously a declining trend in unemployment. Business surveys, you know, the ISM survey of manufacturers, PMIs, which are, again are just surveys of businesses, they're all on the mend or all running at quite solid levels. Retail sales have been quite good. Housing indicators, which have slowed down and started to pick up again. Signs as to whether companies are going to invest are also looking pretty good. So all of these things are telling me that the US economic recovery is on track despite a soft patch at the start of the year.
What measures are the European Central Bank taking to improve the economy in Europe?
I guess one impression one gets out of Europe is that Mario Draghi, I like to call him Super Mario, as some other people do, may take a while longer than the Americans take to get things done, and that reflects the political overlay that surrounds the European Central Bank and the different perspectives of central banks from the individual countries. For example, the Bundesbank is very focused on avoiding inflation or hyperinflation, others are more focused on getting their economies out of recession. So that creates tensions and takes a while longer to get things done than is the case, for example, when the US Fed does things. But at the end of the day, Mario Draghi has moved quite aggressively, first back in 2011-2012, to effectively put an end to the Eurozone sovereign debt crisis. Then, of course, we have seen the recovery in Europe come through. Draghi has concluded that's still a bit too slow. There are these concerns that inflation might turn into deflation. So he stepped in again with more measures, basically cutting interest rates from very low levels to even lower levels. And in fact, one of their rates went negative to encourage banks to lend money out rather than leave it on deposit with the ECB. He's also announced various measures to encourage the flow of funding, cheap funding, from the ECB to the banks. So it's almost like a funding for lending arrangement. I guess it was about seven measures in there altogether on their own. Any one may not have much of an impact, but given that Mario Draghi seems to have thrown the kitchen sink at the slower growth in Europe and the risk of deflation, you know, I'd be reasonably confident that in combination those measures will help.
Thanks for your time today, Shane.
My pleasure. Thank you.
And that brings us to the end of the July PD sessions. Thanks for watching. If you have any feedback or questions, please drop us a line at pdcontent@kaplan.edu.au. I'm Ron Wilson. See you again next time.